we are looking at how think tanks have changed, how have internal and external processes changed, and has the pandemic impacted the goals and objectives of the organization? Has there been changes in the way think tanks have been working, and what are the stakeholder dynamics that we are dealing with? Yeah. These are the issues that are. So from Pakistan, Dr. Suleri is sharing his experience in Pakistan of SPPI, and I'm sharing my experience at SEPA in Sri Lanka. We are not going into any details of discussing about what think tanks are, etc. It's basically independent organizations that groups of people come together to do research, generate knowledge, and share this, disseminate it to important stakeholders. That's what we are doing. Now, the pandemic gives us a good opportunity to reflect on how we have worked and if we need to re-strategize the way we are working. Each of us working in our independent capacities in our different countries, we are successful in certain ways, but we could be more successful if we network and strengthen our capacities across borders, so to say. So in terms of the pandemic gives us a good opportunity to reflect, learn, and redirect ourselves. That's how I see it. We're not going to discuss about the pandemic itself in detail. It gives us a context that we're talking about for the think tanks. So, just to share some basic information about the country as well as the pandemic situation, and I hope you can see the slides now that I've sent. Basically, what I'm presenting is in March 2020, we had the first case of COVID in Sri Lanka, diagnosed as positive. Now, since then, the situation has actually developed where practically the COVID is there in all of the different districts, excepting for two small pockets of a medical officer's area up in the north. Other than that, it's all in the different places. So the parameters that have been used to measure the prevalence of COVID is presented in the slide. So yellow means that no cases have been reported. Green is low risk, where it has been reported before 14 days. And red means cases reported within 14 days. So which means that it's all over the country. Now, Health Promotion Bureau of Government of Sri Lanka gives the following statistics, which are important. The Sri Lanka population is 21 plus million people. Life expectancy is in its 70s, for 72 for men and 79 for women. Population under 15 is about 30%, 15. And then the over 70, 65 is 8% of the population. So at present, this data is monitored on a daily basis. At present, when I check last, the COVID positive patients are 218,000. Deaths about 0.92%. Globally, it's 2.16%. So Sri Lanka is, in terms of global rates, is pretty okay, good. So recovery and discharge is 84%, whereas global it's high. So our recovery and discharge rates are low compared to global standard. Okay, so we'll go on to this. I'm going to the okay, when it comes to comparing in the two different countries, the COVID deaths per 1 million people, Sri Lanka is 6, whereas in India it's 251. Southeast Asia region as a whole is 210. So in terms of the comparatively, Sri Lanka is fairly okay. In terms of vaccinations, we have 20 million people in the country. Then first dose has been administered 2.2 million people. This is an interesting situation. I will talk about it in my later presentation about the politics of this. So the managing the pandemic, I have put some points here. So we had a pandemic, which is known as the Spanish flu, which all of us now talk about. But the older generation of people, older than I myself, they remember this quite well. But I think this memory has faded and people don't know too much about what happened in the past when the Spanish flu hit the world. Sri Lanka, our situation is that I've collected this information from the literature that is available, research literature on the pandemic and related issues. So what we have seen is in the Sri Lanka, the mechanism that has been developed to manage the pandemic is extremely state-centric and very politicized. It's not an inclusive thing, and it has been taken away from keeping its center in the public health domain. So it has been taken out of that. And the mechanism that they have set up, the government has set up, is extremely militarized. So it's a military that is actually at the helm of the entire machinery, which has created a lot of concerns. But the government has continued regardless. So although there are independent think tanks that look at various issues, including the pandemic, whether the government actually takes this into account is quite questionable. So the government has adopted a very divisive approach to dealing with the pandemic. The research shows that it's the benefits that go to the affected people is not equitably distributed, that it's very unequally distributed. Particularly, there's a lot of political patronage that decides who gets what. That's another major issue is that there is information overload. There's a lot of stuff moving around in the internet, and the reliability and the validity of this information is highly questionable. So amongst the various agencies that are responsible for managing the COVID, there is no public private partnerships that actually come up, that has the ability to deal with many of the issues that we are facing. So I'm moving down. Okay, so in terms of the think tanks, they are known to be, we know that they produce very high quality research, knowledge products, and there's a quite a good production of information that is disseminated in ways that each agency or think tank is comfortable and uses. So there's a very high use of social media. And it's continuous, and they still maintain the reputation of being independent researcher. I put it within quotes. Even there, one can question degree of independence. There are lots of things that we would like to do, but for various reasons, particularly because of funding situations, we are then get driven to donors or the funders' agenda. I hope you understand what I'm trying to say. So there is research going on, there is funds coming in, but then the funder decides what are their priorities. Now, in terms of the areas in which we need improvement, is that we tend to be rather insular. There's limited discussions amongst the different think tanks, and there is limited sharing of experiences amongst the think tanks. We tend to operate in our own comfort zones. There's very limited activism amongst the think tanks as a collective to influence, to advocate for change, and efforts to influence government and policymaking can be much stronger and much better. The fact that we don't come together is the limitation. There is very little public mobilization, public opinion mobilization, activism that we can be proud of, hardly any activities that people get out to show their resentment, either in the social media or physically outside. So we don't operate on a campaign mode other than in the social media, which is effective to some extent, but not fully robust and effective. So we don't have a common coordinated media or knowledge products development. We don't have a shared way of doing this. Although there are various ICT-based platforms in which each of us operate, but not a collective platform. So what we could, so production of these material, policy briefs, etc., are independently done, quite independently, and think tank really we are operating in almost like silos, if I can say. So that needs to change. The COVID, as well as many others, problems requires a multidisciplinary approach. And then amongst these different think tanks, there would be that required mass of multidisciplinary personnel, which can be brought together, mobilized in order to respond to public health issues such as the COVID or any other thing. So there needs to be a coordinated effort, which we don't have, moderated probably in a cyber hub that brings organizations and individuals together for debate and so on. So then coming back to the last point, is that this initiative, which talks about a regional collective strength, is necessary, that can have influence on governments and other important stakeholders, is a really required thing in the present context as well as for the future. I'm new to this game. I'm new to SEPA. I like to see a little bit more coherence in terms of the personalities and institutions that are in this particular think tank network. I like to see a situation where we create some kind of a platform where each of us come to know better who we are, what we are, and what we're doing in terms of think tanks, research and advocacy work. That will help me to network with like-minded people. I like that to come out from this. But in terms of strengthening networks, I think that would be an important outcome if we can work towards that. That's number one. Number two is we are all generating knowledge. I have 3 points. Huh? Number one, this. Second is that we are all generating knowledge in our different spheres of life and work, but we are not necessarily sharing this knowledge effectively. Now with this new technology, we could be doing that a little bit more, maybe through a common kind of a platform where we identify the kinds of research that is important and that are common interest to members, member organizations in this network, to see what everybody can do and should be doing. Not that we are going to now change the whole of our agenda, but to have a kind of a regional common agenda that we could work on one or two issues, not more than that. I like that to be happening. Number three is that to see how we can synthesize this knowledge into some kind of a product, maybe a website, journals and publications are becoming a bit obsolete. A mechanism for synthesizing this knowledge and making better use of it. I'd be happy if I am able to see these three outcomes of this exercise that we are having today.